Reaction velocities vary very widely. From the very first ones, such as the acid-base neutralization, to very slow ones that take years or even centuries. According to Arrhenius, reaction rates depend on the energy states and the concentration of the molecules. Kinetic energy considerations. In a biomolecular reaction, reactants' molecules must collide to react. If we assume that all collisions lead to reaction, then 10 degrees rise in temperature should result in a corresponding increase in reaction rate. However, 10 degrees Celsius rise in temperature increases collision frequency by only 1%. On the other hand, in many reactions, 10 degrees Celsius temperature rise doubles or even triples reaction rate. For example, in the decomposition of N2O5, at 25 degrees Celsius, specific rate is 3.46 times 10 to the minus 5, whereas at 45 degrees Celsius, specific rate rises to 4.19 times 10 to the minus 4. And further, if we push it to 65 degrees Celsius, specific rate rises to 4.87 times 10 to the minus 3. So then, what is the cause of this discrepancy? According to Arrhenius, at a given temperature, most of the collisions do not lead to reaction. Only a small fraction will do so. This fraction increases rapidly with the temperature. Successful collisions must have a certain critical amount of energy. It had been known from Boltzmann that the fraction of molecules with a particular amount of energy greater than or equal to Ea at a particular temperature T was given by capital N over capital N naught, which is equal to e to the minus Ea over kT. Here, capital N equals the number of molecules with energy equal to or greater than Ea, while N naught is equal to the total number of molecules in the state. Let us now look at the equilibrium reaction. Let us consider the reaction A plus B, giving you C plus D at equilibrium with rate constant for forward reactions K1 and for the reverse K2. Here, of course, capital K, which is the equilibrium constant, is K1 over K2. The variation of equilibrium constant with temperature obeys the law d natural log of capital K over dt is equal to delta H over T squared. Let's call that equation 1. The corresponding graph of energy against reaction progress is given here. This is potential energy plotted against reaction coordinate. As can be seen, the reactants are here, and they will go through that, and the products will be here. On this side, we have E1, which is normally called the activation energy of the forward reaction, and E2, the activation energy of the reverse reaction. And the difference between the two here is delta H, which is usually known as the heat of the reaction. Clearly, as we have said, E1 minus E2 is equal to delta H. Right. Hence, Van 't Hoff's equation, which we have just been looking at, after remembering that K is equal to K1 over K2, becomes d into natural log of k1 minus natural log of k2 close bracket over dt is equal to delta H over t squared, which is equal to capital E1 minus E2 over t squared. This resembles the result of an integration between limits k1 and k2 and E1 and E2, which would be generalized as d natural log of k dt is equal to E over t squared plus b. Here, B is an integration constant. And B equals not from experiment. Or d natural log of K over D1 over T is equal to minus E over R, or natural log of K is equal to E over RT. Or better still, in the way we always know it, k is equal to a e to the minus e over t. This, of course, is the Arrhenius equation. Right. Here is a question for you to try out. Starting with Van 't Hoff's equation relating equilibrium constant with temperature, derive the Arrhenius equation. Try this. It should take you about 5 minutes. Okay, let's look at the Arrhenius equation in a bit of a detail. A plot of k against 1 over t should be linear with the slope minus e over r, and hence we can get e, the activation energy. Alternatively, as we have done always before, make two runs at two different temperatures, T1 and T2. Then, by dividing K1 over K2, which is equal to AE to the minus E over RT1 over AE minus E to the RT over that, which implies that natural log of K1 minus natural log of K2 is equal to minus E over R into 1 over T1 minus 1 over T2. However, we always use those two methods of obtaining E. There is an underlying assumption that the same process occurs at the two temperatures. This is not always true. A closer look at the Arrhenius equation, E is activation energy, K is the specific rate constant, A is the frequency factor, which accounts for 1, molecular collision frequency, 2, the probability that colliding molecules have favorable orientation. A is usually referred to as a constant. It is actually not that constant. A is found to vary as t to the 1/2. However, it is taken as a constant over small ranges of temperature. E to the minus E over RT represents the fraction of activated collisions. When E increases, E to the minus E over RT decreases. That implies K is equal to A times a fraction of the activated collisions. Arrhenius interpreted this to mean that there exists an equilibrium between normal and activated molecules, and that only the activated ones react. For example, take a reaction with EA equal to about 100 kilojoules per mole. At 300 K, E to the minus E over RT is equal to E to the minus 100,000 over 8.3 times 300, which is equal to 4.25 times 10 to the minus 18. Let's raise the temperature to 400 K, and E to the minus E over RT becomes 9.38 times 10 to the minus 14. That's a dramatic increase. That is, the fraction of activated molecules increases by 10,000 times with an increase of 100 degrees Kelvin in temperature. The frequency factor. Within experimental error, A is constant over a small range of temperatures. This can be tested by plotting E against T from the Arrhenius equation, K equals A, E to the minus E over T. And a straight line is obtained as shown in the diagram here. There is the straight line, E plotted against T. However, when we plot natural log of K against 1 over T, A is assumed constant as mentioned earlier. This is also true when we use K values at two different temperatures to calculate EA, again, as we mentioned earlier. And when we do this, we always obtain a plot of this kind. The slope of this is equal to minus E over RT. The intercept gives you A. However, there are cases where we do not get a single straight line. We may get two straight lines, we may get three or four or five straight lines. This implies that we have got several energies in operation, probably because not the same process is occurring at all the different temperatures. In such a situation, The composite graph would look like the one we have here. Again, it's natural log of k plotted against 1 over t. We will have an EA1 here and an EA2 here, where, of course, here it means EA2 is greater than EA1. This usually could also imply that there are two mechanisms in operation. At low temperature, EA1 is possible, and at high temperature, EA2 operates, because when more molecules acquire more energy,